All right, it's 2 o'clock. I'm gonna go ahead and start. So, my name is Patrizio Pigliapoco. People call me Pat. People call me Teezio. I'm Chris Brown's recording and mixing engineer. I also mix and record for other people. Today, I'm gonna go over like 3 things that I wanna show you that are really important within the stuff that I do. The first thing and the most important thing is for any engineers, the template. So the template for me, I'm gonna go through it so you guys can kind of just see where I'm at with it, and then we'll jump into the AutoTune portion of it. But we're gonna start with the master, which is extremely important. Gain structure, output volume, everything is there. After that is gonna be my reverb main and my delay quarter note. Simple H delay, nothing complicated. Doesn't have to be complicated to make big records. Then we're gonna go to the BG Vox 2. This is just an extra BG Vox that I have for when we need to take background vocals that in the pre-hook, for example, that need to sound different from the backgrounds in the hook. So I'll put those there, but nothing's going there yet. The next one is my background vocal, which is my background vocal bus, which is where all the background vocals go. Really simple, cut. Chris is actually not as bright as you hear him on the records normally, so there is actually quite a big bump. This is not the final EQ, though, that goes into when mixing his vocal. This is just like a temp thing to get things going. Light compression, lead vocals bus. Again, same thing, light EQ, and then we're gonna move to the tune bus. Now, when you are recording an artist, you have two choices. You can either print the AutoTune, or you can have AutoTune on every single track. The difference is that if you print the AutoTune, there's no changing it. Besides adding, you can add more AutoTune, but you can't take away. So specifically for Chris, he prints all the AutoTune. You'll never hear a Chris vocal without AutoTune on it, because before it even hits the record track, it's running through a bus that's printing the AutoTune onto the vocal. After that is going to be my lead verse buses. The reason why there's two is because when you're cutting vocals, a lot of times vocals and parts overlap, so you need to have that to be able to stagger. So for the verse 1 and 2, I'd have my V1 and 2 tracks that will stagger. Pre-1 and 2, so that's for the pre-hook. Hook 1 and 2, again, staggered on the leads. And then ad-lib 1 and 2. And there usually sometimes is maybe a third ad-lib. It depends if we're harmonizing an ad-lib and we need a third track. But I usually start with 2. I can always duplicate and make another one if I need to. After that is going to be my 3 record tracks. Now, the reason why I have 3 record tracks is because the first one down here, record track 1, I'm using to record vocals. The other 2 above it are my workspace. So when I'm recording a vocal, and I, instead of dragging this vocal, let's say, all the way up here to V1, you know, I can literally just drag it here, and then I'm over here, and I drag it here, and let's say we're done with the verse. Once I'm done, I can now drag this together up to the top. So this is my workspace where I can quickly drop things and keep it moving to the right. After that is gonna be my background tracks. So usually for the hook, I keep the same method as I do with the leads. I'll have the 4 background tracks and 4, so they can stagger in case the backgrounds on the hook have to overlap. And below that are my harmony tracks, which I color code. I usually do my highest notes on like pink and my lowest notes on like brown. So the in-betweens are for mid harmonies and stuff like that. This just makes it easy when you're coming down and you're recording and maybe you're doing a bunch of harmonies and you get to the end of the hook and all of a sudden it's that same harmony recorded over here. But when you have, let's say, 30 harmonies and nothing's color coded, it's really hard to see where you're putting that track down to. So having the colors really just helps keep everything visual and quick and precise. After that, down here is my pre-backgrounds. I usually keep the pre-stuff below the hook because when we start a song, 9 out of 10 times, we're going to start recording by the hook, and then we'll move to the verses. There are few chances when we do start with the verse, and at that point, I just move the tracks up and then call it a day. So we're going to jump into what happens when you pull up a template. You're about to start recording with an artist. 3 things have to happen. Pull up the session, get the tempo, and get the key, and then you can start recording, right? So the main thing that's going to happen is right now I'm going to choose, let's pretend we're not working with Chris, and we're going to have AutoTune on all these tracks down here. Boom, go here, boom, 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 where are we? AutoTune access, excellent. So now we have AutoTune on all these lead tracks. Boom, there we go. Okay, cool. So now we have AutoTune in the session. The artist says, let's pull up a song, let's pull up a beat. So I'm going to import a beat. Boom. First thing we're gonna get to do is get the tempo. Now normally I would tap the tempo with the T, get the tempo. There's multiple ways of getting it. There's like beat detection, whatever way works is best. The most important thing that people don't do when they bring the beat is they don't account for this gap right here. You see that gap right there? You gotta take that out. Because when you're making cuts on the beat and you're making edits, they won't be right on the beat. And when you're flying stuff, it won't be right on the grid, so that when you do a beat drop, it'll actually pop and it'll click. So that's done now. And now we need to get the key of the song so that the artist can start recording. So at this point, I have to leave Pro Tools and I have to go to Mixed and Key in order to get the key and come back to Pro Tools. And that's just a big waste of time for me. So what I do is I bring in the beat. I have, let's say, this AutoTune up. So you can see it's in C major right now. And the artist is like, all right, let's do this beat. Cool. So I'm going to pull up right here. Boom. Antares auto key. As soon as it pulls up.
E flat minor. Now watch up here in the left of this AutoTune access. Boom. E flat minor. And that actually happened across all the AutoTune tracks. So they're all on E flat minor now. Instantly. The artist could have already been in the booth, starting to get level, and boom, I hit send to all AutoTunes. He's already in the right key. No issue. I don't have to
sit and copy each AutoTune down, which is normally what you had to do, which is a huge time waster. And you can imagine if you have 30 to 40 to 50 tracks, you know, it's going to be a kind of a pain in the ass to copy each AutoTune down all the way down the line every time there's some sort of key change. So yeah, that's a basic setup of getting a template setup, bringing in the beat, and quickly getting the tempo locked in and getting the key and the artist is in the booth and moving. That's the most important part. A lot of people, they don't realize that in the moment of everything happening and the artist going in the booth, there's no patience happening. Everything has to happen immediately because the artist does not care about anything you have to say. He just wants things done. So this right here is going to save a bunch of time when you're getting the key and getting the tempo. Awesome. Let's jump into something else really quick. There's a song called Heat with Chris Brown and Gunna. And I just wanted to show you guys something that I did with the mix with a plugin called the Avox Duo. It's one of my favorite plugins that I use to create a stereo image of a sound that was not normally in stereo, it was in mono. So I'll show you right now as soon as this opens. Okay, I'm gonna play the first like 20 seconds, 30 seconds of the song just so you guys can get familiar and then we'll jump right in. Awesome. So this record right here doesn't have a lot of sounds, which allows each sound to actually carry a little more weight in the mix. So every sound has its place. I really like mixing records that don't have a lot of sounds because I can spend time and kind of take my time to place things where I feel they should go. Sometimes when there's a ton of sounds, you're just looking for anywhere to stuff a sound and figure out where it can go and still be heard. But I'm going to mute the vocals quickly. And let's jump into this Avox Duo. So when I got the mix, Buddha Bless This Beat is actually the guy who made the beat. He's a friend of mine. I'm going to play you the sound that I'm talking about. I'm going to isolate it. I want you guys to hear it without the Avox Duo. It's just a mono sound. It's left heavy, so it's going to be off to the left a little bit. But I'm going to play it for you here. Awesome. So that's the sound right there. And I'm going to show you the Avox Duo. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to take that sound and I'm going to make it completely stereo. It's not going to be anything in the center, left and right. I'm going to show you quickly how I did it. Within the plugin, when you open it, you're going to want to select instrument, especially because I'm using an instrument. You could do it to the vocals, alto tenor, baritone bass. But in this instance, we're going to be using instrument. The pitch variation for this one, I put it all the way up. The pitch variation is actually going to change slightly the pitch of both sides that it's created in order to create more of a difference between it so that you hear the stereo image a little bit stronger. And the second thing is the timing variation. The timing variation is going to change the difference of when one plays and when the other one plays. And the further apart the time, the more different and wider they actually sound. The closer together, the more in the center they're going to sound. So on this one, I didn't touch the vocal timbre and I didn't touch the vibrato. Obviously didn't think it was necessary, but let's play it and hear it with this plugin on. I'm gonna turn it up so you guys can hear it. I'm gonna play it one more time. So as you can see, this sound, if you're looking at the waveform right here, is actually left heavy. So I had to compensate for that over here on the plugin on the output of the original. The original is gonna be the left signal and the double is actually gonna be the right signal. So given that my left signal was hot, I brought it down 6 dB because although I created the stereo image, I wanted a stereo image that was symmetrical and not something that was off to the left. So that's how I compensated between that. And I'm gonna play the sound now in the music mix instrumental, but I'm gonna turn the sound up so you guys can hear it. You can hear this, that tom is actually an important piece of the beat because the kick, the hi-hat, I mean the snare, they're the basic elements, but this is something that gives it like a nice flavor. So that's one way of using the AVOX Duo. It's really dope to use on instruments, vocals, anything. I feel like other plugins like the doubler, they create sometimes like a weird chorusing effect or a weird out of pitch effect. This actually, you can just mess with only the timing variation, which will give you a nice split without affecting too much of the pitch. So yeah, that's the heat session. This is literally the mix session for the song. I mixed it on this laptop here. I've now upgraded to a Bryson Bulldog computer, which is custom 14 core. So yeah, good stuff. I'm gonna jump into the next and last thing. So there is an artist named CL, and she's from Korea. She's a big, big K-pop artist that used to be in a group called 21. She is here in the United States now. She's managed by Scooter Braun. She's doing big things with her career. Obviously, she's a big idol in Korea already. I did a mix for her. I actually do all of her mixes and cut all her vocals as well. She doesn't work as much as Chris, so I'm able to do it a little bit, you know, still be able to work with her full time and Chris at the same time. I'm gonna play you the mix, just the first 30 seconds, so you guys can hear the song and get familiar, and then we'll jump into what I did over in the bridge. I'm gonna jump in to the bridge and I'm gonna show you. First, I'm gonna play the mix. I want you guys to hear this effect that I did. So I'm gonna play the actual mix up here I have. This all, again, is not the mix session. This is a stem session that I created from the mix. So this isn't actually where the song was mixed. This is just something for you guys to be able to see what I did. I'm gonna play you the bridge from the actual song so you can hear it, and then we're gonna recreate it together. Okay, cool. So before the harmonizer effect was on there. Cool, so that was the basis of where we started with the song. After that, I've created a double of the vocal. I just made a copy of it because this is going to be the affected copy that I'm actually going to blend into the lead. So first thing I did, pulled up a plugin that Antares makes called the Harmony Engine 4.1. This Harmony Engine here, I'm sure a lot of you have seen it. Usually the way I see people using it is they'll throw this on there, they'll put the key in, and they'll attempt to make their own sort of harmony for the vocal to flow through. Now the problem with that is sometimes is that the vocal harmonies don't actually move. So I actually created a harmony engine that was triggered by MIDI. So I had the producer, One second. I had this producer send me the MIDI from the song, and I used that to trigger the harmonizer to go over this part. So first thing you need to do, it's very simple to do. You come up to the top where it says scaled interval and go straight to MIDI Omni. This whole thing now is in full control of anything that's triggering it through MIDI. So we're just going to close this. We're going to come here. So I got to put the mouse down, but bring in the MIDI. So we're going to go here. We're going to go to NAMM. I quit. MIDI is here. When you bring the MIDI in, make sure you select MIDI track and not instrument track, because you're going to have to make a MIDI track anyways if you don't. So make the MIDI track. It's going to come in. Perfect. All right, cool. So the next step is to make this MIDI track right here and this MIDI trigger that harmony engine. So what you need to do, I actually automatically did it since it's pretty much the only thing allowing to trigger, but you go to the output, I quit, CL lead, which is the track right above it, harmony engine, channel one, select it, and now let's solo this. We're gonna solo save the MIDI track, solo this, and play it and see if it worked.
Open it up.
So you can see as the chords are changing in the MIDI down here, the vocal harmonies are also changing, and it's giving it that really tasteful, luscious, harmonizing vocal. So let's actually blend this into the mix now and see what it sounds like. Does anybody have any questions about how that works? It's really simple and easy to use. It's literally pulling this up, dropping it into MIDI Omni, and then any MIDI track you have can now trigger that harmonizer. So yeah, that was my presentation. I hope you guys liked everything I showed you. Appreciate it.